So topic would be and structure of the class. We will learn about the horizontal analysis, about trend analysis, vertical analysis, and the last one is about the ratio analysis, which is would be the most important for today's topics. So the learning outcome of this session would be so preparing the comparative balance sheets using horizontal and vertical analysis techniques. That is what we are going to do. So here is key terms you must be able to use in the future. That is trend, analysis, horizontal, comparative balance sheets, ratios, the types of ratios, which is profitability, liquidity, asset management ratio, and debt management ratios. As we are going to learn. So, the ratio analysis, let's talk about the financial analysis when we do. Why we need to make some analysis on the company, business, or any kind of organization. Okay, before to start this, that you say that I haven't teach you about the accounting for limited companies. No, I have done it. Just let me see first by the structure. So I have done it on the last Friday, on the last week. That the accounting for limited companies topic, which was a very short topic, didn't include the profit and loss account, income statement account, you remember? We have done it already. I do remember that one. So today we are going to study about the ratio analysis, that is, which is very important under financial management. So any successful business, the company or the organizations, is should be evaluated by the performance, right? We do evaluation of our own business if we have so, or company where we do work, and trying to compare with the companies which is historic figures, or we can do compare them our financial statements with the industrial competitors that we have in the market, or even we have can make comparison with the successful business from the industrial side. The successful businesses, we call it benchmarks. You know that. That we can compare our financial statements, our performance, I mean our business or company's performance with the rest of companies which we have in the market. So it can be the same of the forms of companies. And mostly we do comparison with the same of the let's say the share which is the market trends as well. So to complete some examination of your business effectiveness, how if you would like, you need to look at more than just easily numbers like sales or profit that, or total assets that we have done. You remember we have done the preparation financial statements, which is income statement, balance sheet. We can see our sales, the net profits or net incomes. That as well we can do some analysis or conclusion based on these numbers. But also as a masters, as you are the futures or the existing top manager, you must be able to read between the lines of your financial statements and to make them seemingly inconsequent numbers accessible and comprehensible. That means to make those numbers understandable and clear. So when we do any kind of financial analysis of our the company's performance based on financial statements, we'd like to see the effectiveness of our business, right? We'd like to see the weakness and strength of our business. And as well, we'd like to see if we have any risk to in the investment if we have or will have the futures project. This is the wide duration, any kind the trend or horizontal analysis is very important. So to make the financial analysis, which we call horizontal or vertical, the ratio analysis inside of this, which is part of horizontal and vertical analysis, we use the comparative balance sheet. So what is the comparative balance sheet? This is the current and past financial reports, the covering two or more successful periods that place data in single columns side by side. That means we're just taking, for example, if we do the examination of our the business performance based on income statement. So we can take income statement of the existing year and the income statement of the previous year and do comparison and see the changes that if we what kind of changes we have in our amounts. As well, we can do this kind of comparing with the balance sheet to see the changes in our equities, in our assets and liabilities. So what is actually the horizontal analysis that I am talking about? This is amounts of items compared on the same line of comparative financial reports. So we are comparing two figures across columns from one period to another. So later in the slide I have the sample for you to show what is what it looks like, horizontal, the comparative balance sheets. So we can with the in the horizontal analysis when we could do the companies the performance analyzing, we can see the increasing or decreasing in the percentage as well in the amount. So we compare the existing year with the previous, which is could be the base year, or we can do comparison amount of a few years or a few periods of our financial statements. So, as well, we have a trend analysis. This is a type of horizontal analysis. So, it deals with the percentage changes in items on the financial reports for several years. So, we are doing comparison for several years and can see the increase or some decreases in the percentage. So, we use the basic year to calculate the percentage change of each item. So, that would be shown here. I hope. Oh, here is. So here is given to the comparative balance sheet of the Hessler Corporation on December 21st of 2008 and 2007. So here is. I would like to mark you and explain what we have. Okay. Just mark. So we have 2 years, right? Let's assume that the 2008 is the existing year and 2007 is the previous year, which is the base year, the basic year that we do comparison with the basic year. And so in the trend analysis, we can see increase in decreasing in the percentage comparing 2 years. Here is we can see. So we can see the change in the amount. For example, the cash for 2007 was 12,300, right, in US dollars, and the 2008 is being 16,500. So we have some increases in 2008 compared to 2007 by the 4,200. So our cash is being increased. That is shows the good results, right? As well, we can see here is the increase in decrease in the percentage. So here is in the percentage, our the cash been increased by the 34% in overall. So and each amount, each items you can compare and see differences between the 2 years. Like accounts receivable, here is we can see liabilities, stockholders' equity items. So in the total, let's see the overall amounts of the total assets. For 2007, it was 470,700, and then it been for the 2008 495,900, right? So here is, we have some increases in the total assets by the 25,200. So it's around 5.4% in increase. That means our total assets has been increased in 2008 compared to 2007. So the performance overall is in a good condition, right? So we can see almost it's been increased in the all kind of items, excluding the retained earnings. Have you seen? We have a negative amount, and the changes is being decreased by the 9,300 in the 2008. Is being, which means it's been decreased by the 10.5%, right? But if we see the total liabilities in equity, is our liabilities in equity has been increased in 2008, sorry, by the 5.4%. So even if we have some items inside of our like liabilities or assets which is being decreased, we can assume, for example, if retained earnings has been decreased, right? We might assume that this money, which is in 2008, they might went for some kind of investment, or the companies paid the dividends. So here is, this is a comparative balance sheet when we have 2 years and comparing the amounts of 2 years in the amount and as well in the percentage, right? So, and we're showing the results as it increased or decreased at the columns here is. So this is the trend analysis, or we call the horizontal analysis, is the most simple analysis that you can do your own in Excel format that is easily to identify the changes in the amounts as well in the percentage. Just put in the formula like the last year minus the basic year. So you will get your increase or decrease in the amounts of the year 2000 in the last year. Yeah, we do. So here is, this is based on this horizontal analysis, we do comparison of the two or several years and to find that have did our, for example, assets or liabilities has been increased or decreased compared to the previous years. So the accounts, they do prepare this balance, this kind of analysis for the management. So let's see next one. I have a next. As well, we do the comparison based on income statement. Here is given to you the comparative income statement of upper company. The same things as we have previously. The basic year 2007 and the existing, for example, 2008. So we have some increase and decrease in the amounts. Here is, we can see in our columns 2008. As well, we can show the our increase or decrease in the percentage. At the total, if you can see our by net income, it has been increased by $411 million. It's around 44.5%. That is a good result, actually. It's approximately 45% net income being increased compared to previous years. So that is a good result for the company. So what is it? We have as well the vertical analysis. So before we have done the horizontal analysis, which means horizontal. So we do comparison by columns, right? The vertical analysis compares the items in the financial reports like income statement or balance sheet by expressing the each item as a percentage of a certain base total. So let me show you what here is. We have a Hassler Corporation comparative balance sheet based on vertical analysis. So we can, so we are going to see the percentage, the amount of the percentage of a certain base. Like certain base, here is given us total assets. So total assets is equal to 100%. So based on this formula, based on this analysis, we can see, for example, how many percentage in cash we have in the our total assets. Like here is given 3.3%, right? Sorry, some of you says me that it's a 1 year only. So we can do comparison between the several years, or we can do the analysis based on existing or previous year to see how many percentage of, for example, cash or like prepaid expense we have in the total assets. Like in certain base, which is total assets comes with a certain base of amounts. As well, here is total liabilities and equity is equal to 100%. And in this 100%, we can see how many notes payable we have in the percentage. It's 14.5%. Like the most is the biggest of the percentage of the shares is comes with the, let's see, the common stock, right? The common stock is around 60.5% in total liabilities and equity. So common stock, this is the shareholders' capital, right? This actually shows a good picture of the company, that the company has own the capital, which is shareholders' equity, by the 60%, more than 50%. That is shows the good results, that the most money that the company use as resources is the own money, right? As a common stock. So how we do can calculate, some of you ask me how we can make calculation to find them. This is as based on the formula. Let me find it. So when you see your balance sheet, assume you have total assets, which is curious, but for 495,900. So you have to equal to 100%. And the rest one, you do just which is the mathematics, the calculations to find the percentage in and the rest of items. Let me show you just a moment. I wanna to put on your chart the formulas. Like to find the cash, for example, you must take your cash, which is 16,500, multiply on 100% and divide on your total assets, because the total assets equal to 100%. So it's like this.
Yes, and this is okay.
And it would be equal to 3.3% of the cash inside of total assets. If you have done already, that's very good. So this is actually a very simple calculation, right? This is based on vertical analysis. But when I had my previous students, I given this kind of the assignment on the exam, most of them being wrong in the calculations, because they try to make calculation in the Excel format. But when you do in the Excel, sometimes it's copying the wrong copying the formulas. You must be careful and to review that, have you done your correct calculations. So be aware that when you do calculation in the Excel, the formulas would be passed at the correct places. Okay, this is So, okay, some of you asked me that why I didn't put the 2007 year to compare the 2 years. This is just example. So you can do, you can see, if you like to see the amount of change in percentage, how many of percentage you have in the total, your total amounts, you can get your existing year only. If you do would like to compare with your previous year, of course you can get the previous years, two or more than each. This is depends on the management, how do they actually request to make the, that kind of vertical analysis. So we can add here at 2007 as well, if you like, or 2006, and make comparison between among the 3 years. So what is the vertical analysis? So we are comparing the items. Items which is like cash flow, or sorry, for example, the as income statement, which is come could be sales of good sales or cost of goods sold or net income in the balance sheet, which is the current assets or fixed assets. We do comparison with these items in the in our statement, which is could be income or balance sheet, expressing the each item as a percentage of a certain base total. So you see, we are expressing the each item in the percentage, like a cash is equal to 3.3% in the certain of base. The certain of base comes, for example, cash under total assets, and for example, the notes payable under total liabilities in equity. Because this is the balance sheet, where is total assets equal to total liabilities in equity, and these two items we check as a certain base, which is equal to 100% always. Okay, the total assets must be equal to 100%. Any kind of amount would be equal to 100%, and the rest of amount you do calculation to find the each percent the items of percentage. Okay, some you're asking me to give you the 5 minutes for to pray. So is it 5 minutes enough? Or okay, thanks. So just break for 5 minutes. That's okay. I would mute my microphone. Okay, I'm here already. So this is, we have seen the vertical analysis where we do express the items and the percentage of the certain base. The certain base amount, which is equal to 100%, is our total assets on the one hand, and the other hand is the total liabilities in equity. This is how we do in the balance sheet. So let me show you how we can make this analysis on the income statement. So here is income statement of the opera company by the end of December 31st of December 2008. So in income statement as a certain base of a percentage which is equal to 100%, we take the items which is called net sales. The top item of the income statement, our net sales, or we call the revenue, right? Sales, net sales, or just a sales you could find, or just a revenue that you can face in your financial statements. So the net sales, which is, or even is always equal to 100%. And this comes as a certain base of percentage. Then we can express of each item as a cost of goods sold or operating expenses in the percentage. For example, let's see. Like a cost of goods sold is equal to 49.4% in the sales. So that means our cost of goods sold takes the around 50% of the whole sales of the company, of the whole revenue of the company. So the rest of expenses comes under, let's see, the most is our biggest is the selling, which is selling here is the operating expenses under selling. Then some kind of general administrative expense, which is 8.4%. Let's see what else we have. And some interest expenses, which is around 1.8%, right? And income taxes, which is equal to 7.3%. So to see what kind of expense has been taken, the biggest place in our income statement, of course, this is our cost of goods sold, right? Which is equal to 49.4%. And at the bottom of the income statement, you can see our net income, which is equal, and if we see in the percentage, 10.9%, around 11%. That we can conclude based on this income statement, our net income equal to 11% inside of the whole revenues of the company, which is the main the company's operations and activities. That is a good result, actually. This is I'm showing you the sample, which is a good result, which is a positive amount comes as well as a good result by the financial statement. But you, of course, you can face the figures which could be more decreased in the amounts or in the presentation even. We can see some losses or decreases of our sales or of our net incomes. This is a normal situation for all the companies that we have increasing or decreasing and our items. And based on this, we can do analysis, right? We can conclude and see what kind of, if we have a, for example, if our the company policy or the management requires to decrease the expenses in the company, so first of all, based on the vertical analysis, we can see which kind of expense takes the biggest place in our statements, in our financial statements. As we can see, this is the cost of goods sold, of course, right? Which is included as well the raw materials, the salaries for staff, the wages, and if we have this kind of income statement, which is shows you details of items. So in that we can see what we can do to decrease our expenses. The management can offer, or the professional or consultants can offer different ideas for this. Okay, this is okay. So let's continue. This is a vertical analysis based on the income statement. So you do understand the percentage in the income statement you must get as a net sales is always, or the revenue always would be equal to 100%. Then you can express and see the each items in the percentage, right? Okay, what is the common size statement? We have this kind of statement as well. So this is the comparative report, which is the financial statement, in which each item is expressed as a percentage of a base amount without the dollar amount. So we can see the change only in the percentage. The changes, which is decrease or increase, only in the percentage of all items. And why we use this kind of common size statement? They can be used to compare the companies of different sizes. You know that we have the small, medium, the large companies. For example, in the small companies, the income statement can be shown in the thousands of dollars, for example. And the huge companies could be in the millions, right? So the question is how we could compare this kind of two different size companies, which can be at the different market. So we can do comparison only in the percentage. So to see the increase and decrease in the percentage, right? So let me show the example. Can you see the slide of the example of common size comparative income statement of upper company for 2008 and 2007? Okay, here is it's based on vertical analysis because of the certain of amount as a percentage hundreds comes under net sales, and we can see the expression the percentage of each item. And if you do understand what is the common size statement, that where we do use only the percentage differences. Can you see it? We can do compare 2 years or two kind of different companies and see differences in the percentage, not amounts. Because as I told you, the amounts at different companies can be at the million or thousands or even just hundreds, right? So this is what we do actually. Because, for example, if you are as a owner small company and you would like to compare your business with some huge company just to see the effectiveness of your business, of course you can't compare that amounts, the sales or whole revenues because you have a big difference. But with the percentage of this common size statement, you can see how you do. How you do perform with the same industries, but the much more hugest company. So in this kind of you can see, like let's assume the 2008 is a small private owner company, and 2007 let's see some corporation. Let's assume. So in the corporation you can see that the net income, which is equal in in your company around 11%, in the huge company is around 10.5%, is almost is equal. So you do perform good as a huge companies, or the huge company can do comparison with the small. But the most we do comparison as taking the small, medium comp with the hugest comp with the big companies, which is the benchmark companies, right? Of course, where we have, okay, the question is here in this common size comparative statement, where we did find that this percentage, expression percentage, of course we had the figures, right? Before we had the figures. We have taken the expression, the item, our percentage, and just the, just let's say the heighten the columns with the amounts already. You just hide and you can see in the presentation. This is so let's continue. This is all, this is that all for the horizontal and vertical analysis, how we do comparison between the several years or among the different companies, the comparison by the in the percentage of increase and decrease or amounts. Any questions so far based on our vertical and horizontal analysis? If no, we can move on the ratio analysis, which is very interesting and important for all of us. Okay, thanks. So ratio analysis, this is, I like this kind of topic. This is very important because this is very useful topic, very useful calculation we can see that you can use in different companies, in different size of companies or the markets, and where we can do then the analysis of effectiveness of companies. Okay, the learning objective of our ratio analysis topic. So calculating the four different types of ratios. So we have four types of ratios: is liquidity ratios, asset management ratios, debt management ratios, and profitability ratios. Maybe you heard about these kind of ratios. Okay, sorry. Let me see the chart. Some of you just chatting for me. I didn't read it. Sorry. So someone's microphone is on, right? Is there, no, here is. Okay, somebody said that they can't see the slides. Is it all of you cannot see my slides? So just let me. No, that it might happen with the internet connection. So who cannot see the slides and can hear my voice, then I have sent you on email this presentation, you can open it. Right now we are looking at the page of number 18 of ratio analysis. So we have four type of ratios, right? Liquidity, asset management, debt management ratio, and the profitability. Let's see the in details each of them. To proceed before, we are going to study what is actually ratio analysis, why we need to make this analysis, what it actually express. This is the tool which is used by the individuals to conduct a quantitative analysis of information in the company's financial statement. So we use the ratio analysis to make the analysis which is quantitative, which is to see the companies, the effectiveness. And ratios are calculated from current year numbers and are then compared to the previous years. This is how we do in the vertical and horizontal analysis, right? The same we do comparison the like existing year with the previous year. And as well, you can do comparison between the companies, the industries, or you know, with the economy to judge the performance of the company. Like, if you're in Afghanistan, you run your own company, if you would like to make comparison, to compare your company with the company of the same market, but in different locations, which could be the different country, so you can use the ratio analysis as well. So the ratio analysis helps to examine the relationship between two numbers or set of numbers of the financial reports. So when you can see the words financial reports, this is all about the financial statements, right? Income statement, the balance sheet, and cash flow statement. These three kinds of statements that we're going to use in our calculations. And as well, the ratio analysis can indicate how well the company conducts its business, how well it runs its business, right? So, and the comparative ratio analysis helps you to identify and quantify your company's strengths. So, with this analysis, when you do calculation, of course, you can see only figures, but this, with that kind of figures, you can identify your main company's strengths, as well your weakness. You can evaluate even your financial position and the market, or your financial position for the current year, and understand the risk you may be taking. That means the risk you may be taking at the current time, or you might be taking in the future. For example, if you would like to make any investments. As well, we do ratio analysis use as to compare the company's financial figures over a period, and as well, this is the method sometimes called trend analysis that we have seen in the previous, which is horizontal, which is the type of the trend analysis, right? Through trend analysis, you can identify your trends. You can identify good and bad, which means the good performance or bad performance of your company. And adjust your business practice accordingly, which means you can make corrections in your businesses if you need so. You can also see how your ratios stack up against other businesses, both in and out of the industry. That means you can do comparison with the different the rest of companies at the same industry. So let's see the main calculations of the ratio analysis. Okay, I have some question. Let me see. Okay, the question is, if the inversion is, we can compare 2 years, but you're asking about what is the difference between the horizontal and vertical analysis. So all these three kinds of analysis, which is the horizontal vertical analysis, you can do comparison between 2 years, for example, the existing with the previous, or as well you can do a comparison among several years. You can get the 5 or 10 even years to make a comparison to see how you've been effective in your business during the 10 years, as example. And as well, you can do the comparison with the different industries or different companies, or the same companies as you, but in the different countries, for example, in different locations. If you can see, if you would like to see how did you conduct geographically, for example. And in horizontal, we do see the changes in the amount, in the percentage. In the vertical, we can see only how many of the percentage of each item comes under certain of amount. But the ratio analysis is a little bit different. I haven't shown you the calculation yet, so we'll see. You do understand. And the question is, which is the method which is analysis is the best one? I can say that the horizontal and vertical analysis show you just a draft of your changes of your in your companies or between the several years, for example. But the ratio analysis shows you in details your effectiveness of your performance, the companies, and show you each items how it's been in the financial statements it's being expressed. Yeah, that is would be the examples. Practical exercise would be will help me to explain you like in more detail. So one more thing. Before make calculation, to see the calculation of ratio analysis, here is some point that we must consider when we do comparison with different kind of the companies or industries. The first one, if you are making the comparative analysis, which is can be horizontal, vertical, or ratio, of your company's financial statement over a certain period of time, like over the certain years, make an appropriate allowance for any changes in accounting policies that occur during the same time span. That means, if you'd like to make the comparative analysis of your company based on the statements, example among the several years, right? You must do consider under which kind of account policies you have done your statements. It's very important. If it would change, then of course the figures would be changed. Then the results shows you as different changes and amounts in the percentage and the amounts as well. The second one, when you compare your business with the others in your industry, allow for any material differences in accounting policies between your company and industry norms. So you must be aware what kind of industry norms we have based on the material differences, which is the differences of accounting policies, and what kind of and under what of accounting policies your company is being following. That is very important. Sometimes, for example, this is like in some countries they have own the accounting standardizations. As I can say, in Russia, I'm not sure which year before they have used their own the accounting standards and rules for accounting, but then now. Already moving to the international standards for European standards of accounting. So, like in that kind of situation, if you have in your country your own standards and you would like to compare your company with the different located companies in the same industry, of course you have to consider under which kind of account policies you've been followed, you have and those companies for comparison has been followed as well. Like you know the difference in your accounting policies with different countries, for example. And this must be aware because it can be resolved in the financial statements. Yeah, norms and standards. Okay, next one. When comparing the ratios from various the fiscal periods on companies, inquire about the types of accounting policies used. Different accounting methods can result in a wide variety of report figures. This is as well important. What kind of types of account policies you have been used in your accounting? If you'd like to compare your company with a different one, with the rest of, and this is of course, for example, depends on. You remember we have done depreciation methods. For example, if you use in your accounting the depreciation on the straight line methods, then what about the other company? Because when we do depreciate our assets and the different kind of methods, which is straight line or reducing balance method, our results would be different, right? You remember? Because they have different formulas, and reducing balance methods would be having a higher charge in the earliest year. So it all affects your results at the end of the period in your financial statements. So as well, you have to be aware of these kind of things. Next one, the fourth, determine whether variations were calculated before or after any adjustments were made to the balance sheet or the income statement, such as non-recurring items or inventory or the pro forma adjustment. In many cases, there is adjustments can significantly affect the ratios. So about adjustments when we do the income statement or balance sheet, for example, as earnings, for example, the earnings, when we are adding in the income statements or dividends or even inventory in the balance sheet, all these items, because they have an amount value, right, they would affect your current results, the last results on your statements. So we have to aware about these things as well. And the fifth is to carefully examine any departure from industry norms. So if you like to make comparison of your company with a different industry company, so you must be aware of the industry norms. Like if you have a different market, if you like to make comparison under the different markets, of course we have to in the industry norms, which is like we have different industrial norms, you know, that like in automobile industry or instruction industry, all they have different norms under each of the types. So we have to be concerned about the differences of these industries. So this is all about the points which is we have to make consideration when we do calculation based on ratio analysis. And let's see the ratios itself. So right now we are going to see the financial performance metrics or ratios. So the financial performance analysis, which is the ratio analysis, starts with the fundamental financial statements, which as I told you already, income statement, the balance sheet, and the cash flow statement. And ratios, they are classified into seven categories. Here is liquidity, activity, leverage, the profitability, market growth, and the cost management. So first of all, the type of ratio which calls liquidity ratios. This is very the first comes ratios when we do any kind of calculations, and very interesting and important for the businesses because it measures the company's ability to meet the short-term obligations. For example, under liquidity ratios, the first ratio comes called the current ratio. What is the current ratio? It indicates the company is able to pay its short-term debts. So that means how fast the company can pay its short-term debts that it has. The formula is the following. We must take our current assets and divide on the current liabilities. So these items we can get from the balance sheet, right? So, when I give you the practical exercise based on ratio analysis or on your exams, I always give you two types of statements, which is income statement and the balance sheet, because all the items we are going to use for calculation we can get from these statements, from those statements. So the current ratio formula. So current liabilities divide on current current assets divide on the current liabilities. So we can see the company's able to pay short term debts. As example here is given to you. For example, let us assume your current assets equal to 28,815. And your current liabilities for $13,600. And the results is given is a 2.12. The figure means. This figure means that the company is able to pay its short-term debt by the 2 times. So this is very good result and very good figure for the company. That means the company, this company is able to pay its debts, and the company have enough money to pay its debts, and the money which is that it's like assets, the sources is 2 times more than its debt. Next one, we have a liquidity ratio called asset test ratio. Okay, let me back. Okay, current ratio. This means that the company, not the capital, the capital, when we you say capital, we assume that is the company's equity. This is the current assets. What we have done, we have are the current assets. Do you remember in the balance sheet is the cash, right? Some marketable securities, right? Some accounts receivable, right? This is all current assets, as well some inventory, right? So, sorry, we have enough these sources of money to pay our debts. What is our debts? It's a short-term liabilities. For example, some credits which is we have to pay within the 1 year, or some kind of accounts payable, which the some money. Prepayments or payments that we must pay for our customers, we have to make payment for our customers or even for our partners. Or some salaries or wages we haven't paid yet for our staff, but we have to within the year. This is the current liabilities. So, and this is when we say the current ratio, this is short terms money that we have. How fast and how actually in the times how we can how it would be covered for our debts. And here is the result says that the 2.12 that our assets is being 2 times more than our liabilities. So that's good that your assets, your resource is more than your liabilities that you have in your company, right? So we can give a different explanation of current assets that you already given to me as well. Okay, next one is the asset test ratio or quick ratio we call it. So it indicates the company's ability to pay short-term debts as well as the current ratio, but it has a difference. It includes only assets that are easily converted into the cash, which here is. That means the assets we include assets which is easily converted and fast converted into the cash. That means we have to deduct our inventory and prepaid expenses from our current assets, because inventory to convert them into the cash takes a long time, as well the prepaid expenses that we must get the money as our accounts receivables. Sometimes it takes time to get back, so we have to deduct it from our current assets, and as well to divide on the current liabilities to see how company able to pay its debts, its short-term debts. And here is, we have the formula, as you can see. Assume that the current assets is equal to 28,850, the inventory 14,500, and the prepaid expenses 1,200. And divide on our current assets, which is assumed 13,600. So, and here is acid test ratio equal to 0.97. That means almost we are able and can pay our short-term debts by our quick assets, quick current assets. Almost, it's 97, almost is equal to. So that's not bad, actually. That in some kind of example, we can see the war situation. So let me see your questions in charts. Okay, some of you asked me the question is, so if the inventory is difficult to turn to the cash, so what's the point of mentioning it under current assets? But you see the inventory is under current assets, it's difficult, but we can do convert into the cash. But the questions comes under how fast we can do it, you see? The current assets, where is we have under current assets like cash money or the some money on the bank accounts like marketable securities. This is money already done, right? For example, today I can go and get my money and pay my debts if I need so. But for inventory, I need some time, maybe 2 or 3 days to sell my inventory or to change for another kind of thing. So it needs time to convert into the cash. But it's, anyway, it comes under current assets because it won't take so long time as like in like a fixed assets, which we have a land or property or like automobiles, which won't be easy and fast to convert these items into the cash, right? So if our assets, here is the question is, some of you asked me the good question. So what is about if assets are less than our liabilities? So the results would be less than one point, okay? Like here is, we have 0.97, or it could be lesser than it. That means the company has no enough cash money to pay debts. So this is, of course, this is not good for the company, but not is so worse. But company must to manage and prepare always the cash money for the short-term debts. Okay, some of you, yeah, that's a good question is, what's about how we could identify that the results is the good or bad? We have some norms, and the quick ratio, and the acid test ratio, and the current ratio. So, on the current ratio, the figures, our points must be, let me show you, like, norms comes 2.1, like a 2 is a current assets, and where is a 1 is a 1 is a current liabilities. So our current assets must be twice bigger than current liabilities. This shows a good results. That's why I have told you previously that it been a good result in the previous slide, right? In the quick asset ratio, as here is, we exclude the inventory and prepaid expenses. Our norms standards comes like 1:1, where is 1 is the current assets without the inventories and prepared expenses. And the another one is really the prepaid expense. So our current assets must be equal to current liabilities, but not lesser than it. That we can say that is a good result. If we have lesser than in the figures, the point, then we have to think, the company, the company's management think how to manage this problem. Okay, let's continue, okay? You do understand about the current asset test ratio. So we have a norm that I have given to you. I have these norms to show you later in my practice exercise as well. The second type of ratios, we have asset management ratios. This kind of ratio, they measure how effectively the company using its assets, like its resources, how effectively you're using your like fixed assets, your all your equipment, lands, your land or whatever you have, automobiles, and as well your cash money and all the money in the bank. How effectively you're using these assets, these resources to make a, to generate the revenue. Let's see. So the first ratio called accounts receivable turnover. It indicates number of time accounts receivables are converted to the cash within a given period. Indication of effectiveness of company's credit policy. So this, the accounts receivable turnover rate, it shows the effectiveness of the company's credit policy. What that means? Do you know that the effectiveness of company's credit policy? This must be done at the management under management measure. That this kind of ratio, the banks or financial institutions use to see the company's financial credit policy. How the company how it's able to pay its credits in the future as well in the current moment. So here is the formula following. You have to take your net credit sales and divide on the average accounts receivable and multiply on 100%. Here is multiply on 100 must be, I'm sorry that it being missed. Wherever, I don't know where it's been missed, this formula, it's 100 here is. Just to show you, I hope in your emails you have a whole presentation of the slides. Yeah, so this is for the those company which have make a, which made the sales on credit. If you made your sales, you have sold your products on credit, so with accounts receivable turnover rate, we can see how effective your company is selling for credit. So here is, if we have in your income statements this kind of items, you must get your net credit sales and divide on the average accounts receivable item and multiply on 100%. So what is the average accounts receivable? The formula is given to you here is, you have to take your beginning balance plus ending balance and divide on 2. So you can get your accounts receivable in the average amount. Okay, let me, I don't know what's happened with this formula. This is in percentage, yeah, sorry for this. Yeah, okay, just moment. So, first of all, if your company or your company is selling the products on credit, which means on credit, which means your payments, you're not taking the cash, you're not receiving the cash. Like partners or customers say that they would pay later on credit, it's maybe during the few months or weeks, depends how you do manage it. Then we use the accounts receivable turnover rate to see how effective you sell on credit and how effective you can get your money back. Because if we, first of all, we show we must get our net credit sales because of course we are going to sell on the credit. And next one, why we are taking the average accounts receivable? The accounts receivable, this is the money which we have to get in the future. That as well, we might sell it on credit, right? And we are going to see to get this money in the future, which is receivable. You remember, I have given you definitions on the account receivable. So to find your receivable turnover rate, you must get the two kind of items from your statements to see the effectiveness of your credit policy. The net credit sales item you can find your income statement, and accounts receivable you can get from your balance sheet, right? This is so you remember you must already identify these items in which statement they are actually being posted. So this accounts receivable turnover. Let's see next one. Here is just given to you, showing you the calculations. Oh, I'm sorry, it's not in percentage that I've been mistaken. Sorry, this is not percentage. That is being correct. If I, sorry, ignore my words about the, that is in much than 100%. It's not in percentage. Because here is, let's see, in it shows in the times. Let's see the in the examples. Yeah. Like assume our net credit sales equal to 99,000, right? And our average accounts receivable is here is 9,750 at the beginning year, and the 8,700 at the ending year. So, and our accounts receivable turnover equal to 10.73 times, which is means times. That means we as a company, we can our credit sales is more than our accounts receivables by the 10 times, around 11 times. You see? So, but here is in accounts receivable turnover, the lesser amount, the lesser here is the results is the better. Okay, the lower this, the lower results is the better, because if you we can see that the sales is our credit on sales is more than our accounts received, that the money we are going to receive is more than. More than 10 times. So how we could run a business if we can't get our money back, which we sell on credit, you see? This is how we can make conclusion, how we can make some analysis for based on these ratios. So the lower this results in the receivable turnover is the better for the company. Right, it's not in percentage. In the, it's on a. In the time. So, later show you examples, which is very, very interesting and very useful. To see the calculations at a more clear way. Okay, some of you are asking me what is the meaning of the beginning balance and ending balance. It's like you have your income statement, your balance sheet, for example. At the end, at the beginning year, you had some kind of accounts receivable, and of course, you might have at the ending of year the different amount of the accounts receivable. You might get already some money back, or you might already have been sold your products on credit more than it. So you have some differences. You have you can have two different amounts based on your balance sheet. So in this formula, we must get the average amount. So just take your beginning balance plus ending balance and divide on two. Or you might have only one item in your balance sheet, which is could be just called the accounts receivable at the end of year, and won't be show how much it was at the beginning of year. This is why I have shown show you the formula. You can get and see a different statement. Because this is the statement, financial statement, which I'm giving in my examples, it's very easy to read and very simple. We have very simple items. But in huge companies, if you have seen the financial statement, like income statement, they are so huge. They have a lot of kind of details of items, which can be the beginning or ending balance and some expression of the expenses as well. So. So this is you must be aware when you do any kind of calculations that we can have the beginning balance of the figure of any kind of items and the ending of the balance as well. So the net credit sales, these items you will find in your income statements, right? This is net credit sales. This is a sales which been the products which been sold on credit, and the accounts receivable, this amount you can get from your balance sheet, right? You remember that we have this kind of items. So next one, we have some another ratio which calls the average collection period. So I have to tell you that we have more than 15 or 20 different types of ratios, but right now I'm showing you the best, which is the common usage of ratios that we use in ratio analysis. That we the most common and usage of ratios. We have a lot of. At the end of this presentation, I will show the list of all the ratios with their formulas, okay? For your future, you can print for yourself, and if you do some kind of calculation, that will help you. Okay, let's continue. So what is average collection period? This shows how quickly monies owed are received from the customers, and measures how effectively a company collects its accounts receivable. So let's assume we have sold the products on credit, okay, for our customers, and we haven't received the payment for this product, and which we haven't received the money. We call it accounts receivable that we are going to receive in the future, right? So, and this average collection period, it can show us and how effectively the company, how fast can get its money back, its money back. So the formula is the following. We check 365 days, which is 1 year. So, but the different country, they use a different of days in a year. Some of use 360 days, the different standards. In, for example, this is based on British, we use 365 days. In the USA, they might use 360 days. That depends on your country. But I'm giving you based on the UK standards that we're using. Calculation and getting the days in a year, assuming that is the 365, and divide on our accounts receivable turnover. Accounts receivable turnover. So accounts receivable turnover. This formula I will show you later. This is I haven't put here. I don't know why. I think I missed this formula. I will show you how we can get accounts receivable turnover. But for example, first of all, see here is based on the formula. If when we do calculation, we must get 365, which is the days in a year, and divide on our receivable turnover. You remember this was the previous one formula. Accounts receivable. Yeah, here is 10.73, right? This is the formula for accounts receivable turnover. So, at the average collection period, we do the following calculations based on the receivable turnover. You must get your 365 days in a year and divide on 10.73 times of receivable turnover, and you will get the how many days is the here is 34 days that your company can collect its money during the 34 days in the 1 year. This means what it means. Okay. Okay. Let me make a break for your charts. As you can see, you see that is a lot of information for today. Yes, I do agree, because this is a ratio analysis, it's a huge topic. It's very interesting and as well important for you. And yes, we must to complete this topic for today, because we have some practical exercise, which is more than, the practical exercise is very interesting and very huge one. But this is the most important part of the financial management that you must learn. Okay? What we have then the previously on the accounting skills, which is preparing the income statement, balance sheet, that was like, let's say, the first level of the finance at overall, which is how to compare. Like if you like study at school, that was the first class of school, but now we are moving already on high school, which means based on financial management topics. That we have to complete this by today. Okay, so I know that we are already running the class 1 hour and a half, but it's okay. We can do finish around in 10-15 minutes. Okay, we still have a time. Okay, take your coffee and let's continue. So here is we have results. It shows that 34 days that the company can collect its money during the 34 days in a year. Okay, this is safe. So the result, the lower the days we have, is the better results, because the faster you can collect your money back, that's good for company, right? So your financial position would be in a good place as well. Your current assets will be increased. So, okay, next one, we have inventory turnover rate. Inventory, you know, about the stock. You remember we had topics based on stock, that we have raw materials, work in progress, and some already done goods, right? This is our inventories, right? Let's see the turnover of these inventories. What it indicates, actually, the how quickly inventory moves of the shares. That means how quickly we sell our products. How quickly, for example, if I have my shop which is I sell the food, and with this formula I can see how quickly my food moves from the shelf. I can sell my products. Yeah, and the formula is following. We have to get our cost of goods sold, which is comes on the income statement, right? The item from income statement, and divide on average inventory, or just inventory. The inventory, the amount you can get from your balance sheet. Remember, under current assets. So you see, we are using actually two kind of statements, which is income statement and the balance sheet. This is the two main statements that help us to make the ratio analysis. And in the formulas, you can see the combination of these statements, the items of combination. So here is inventory turnover. Let's see the calculations. For example, let's assume that our cost of goods sold is equal to 50,500 and the average inventory, like at the beginning year, is 14,500, at the ending of year is 14,900, then divide by 2. So this is, you can see the average inventory. Or you might have in your balance sheet the item which calls just inventory. That can be shown only the average or the inventory at the ending of the year. So then we can see the result is equal to 3.4. That our turnover rate equal to 3.4. That our inventories moves from the shelf by the 3 times and 4. That is as well. It's a good result that we can sell the products compared to our cost of goods sold by the 3 times. This is later I show you the list which show you the standard norms, all of these ratios. Okay, let me see. Sorry. And the charts. Some of you asked me to stop the class. Let me see how many slides we have. I know this is a huge topic. You shouldn't be compliant because we are almost learning. Yeah, we have around 50 slides, so we have done the half of them, more than a half, 32. I don't know what to say. Yeah, this is a topic is complicated. I'm not going fast. I'm okay because we have left another 3 topics which we must done, and those 3 topics would be already exist from our semester. Can you understand it? That I was trying to finish by the May everything and our exams as well. Okay, let me think. Okay, so actually today, let me explain by our financial class structure what we have done. This is our class number 10, and under financial major, we have 10 classes. You should have 10 class at any kind of majors, right? 10 to 12. And we have another, besides the duration topic, we have three new topics on the financial management, which is the most important as well for you, for your study. But besides of the topics, we will have a practical exercise that takes the time as well, you know. This is maybe for the another two classes. So we have around five classes left, which goes beyond of our programs. That's what I'm talking about. But I'm trying to finish everything by two. I mean the new topic on ratio by today. Okay. Yeah, sorry. Yes. I know it's difficult. I mean it's not difficult, but needs time. So. Okay, we can finish, we can complete class right now, okay? But you my consider that you will have an additional class beyond of your semester. So. Okay, let's complete this topic, and then tomorrow we continue with practical exercise, which is very important as well, okay? So just be considered that you'll be getting some additional classes. We would have two classes in the week, or the next week as well. We must have it to complete all our classes by the May, by the end of May. I mean, as well, it will be the exams in the May. So, okay, let's move. Next one, asset turnover. So it indicates how efficiently the company uses its assets to generate the sales. It helps measure the overall efficiency of the company. You see, this is as well very important the ratios when we do analysis. Because we can see and measure the company's efficiency. So here the formula is the next one. You take your net sales, which is from the income statement, right? And divide on the total assets, which is from you can get from balance sheet. Very simple one. And let's see the here is calculation. The net sales is equal to 99,000, and we do divide on the total assets, which is equal to 43,750. So it shows the results 2.26. That means our sales is more than assets by the 2 times 26. That how we do actually. We generate we use our assets to generate the sales by the 2 times like that the usage of assets is being efficiently. You see that is shows as well the good results. The higher this item, the higher the results. That is the better for the company. That the sales, the more than assets, but by the 2 times more than we can use our assets to generate the sales. Like 2 times we use our assets to get our process, like this. We have no special norms for this race. Because it depends on the market or industry or even the size of the company. So when we do comparison of these items, delicious, I mean, we have to get, we can choose the company, the same company with the same market or industry, same, the same conditions as we do run the business, okay? So then we can see how we do conduct our business compared to the rest of the companies in that kind of industry. And as well, we can do comparison between the several years to see how efficiency, for example, we can use our assets to generate, to get the profits. Next one, we have a debt management ratio. So it measures how well a company using its debts versus its equity position. Okay. So the formula is here is. Okay, the debt management ratios. Under debt management ratios, we have a first debt is debts to total assets. It indicates how much the company's assets are financed by creditors. You see, this the sense already explains you what is kind of ratio. It shows you how much the company's assets, your company assets, which is fixed and current assets, are financed by the creditors, which is a creditor, which is not your money, which is being liabilities, right? The formula is following. You must get your total liabilities, divide on total assets, and multiply on the 100%. So we can see in the percentage. These all items you can get from your balance sheet. So and based on the calculations, for example, we have a result which is equal to 53.9%, around 54%. That means the company's all total assets is financed by the creditors for the 54%, more than a half one. So you might assume and make conclusion: is it good for company that is it's 50% of assets being financed by the creditors, which is not own money? Yeah, if it's more than 50%, that is not good for the company. That says that you have no own money to run your business. Most of your sources of your financial resources being owed from different places. It might be partners or banks or even the customers. Okay, this is how we do conclusion. Next one, next ratio called debt to stockholders' equity. It measures the risk creditors run in comparison with the stockholder. Like, we take our total liabilities and divide on our equity and multiply on the 100%. And in the calculations, we can see the results. The results equal to 117%. You see, that means that the company taking the risks by the 117% of the liabilities compared to equity. You see that we assume that the most of companies' equity, the total liabilities equal to equity. So it's around 50% we have our own capital and our liabilities. So here is the lesser amount in the percentage is better for the company. Okay, that the best, you know, the effectiveness of the financial position of the company, the best figure shows when the company has own capital, right? Own equity, that it can pay for all its liabilities and debts. If it cannot, all of its equities and the sources of financial sources is being taken from the banks as a credit or loan. What we can say about the company's financial position? The risk based on your liabilities. So what about if you need to make some urgent payments? Or you see that where you can get the money, because all of your financial sources is being taken on credit. All is in credit loans or some debts. So this is what I'm talking about. Why is important these ratios? With these ratios, like here is, we can see just formula, just figures, right? But the as you are master, as you are the futures or existing top manager, with these figures you can make analysis of your company. As well you can do forecasting of your company or with that company where you're going to have some partnership. You see, this ratios shows that the company's quality of its efficiency, of its the performance efficiency. That's why we do this. That's why we do learn about this analysis in our financial management classes. Okay, next one is a time interest earning. It indicates the degree of risk to lender that the company will default on its interest payment, which is called, sometimes we call it interest coverage ratio. That means when, for example, the company is taking the credit, for example, it has to pay in the future some interest expense, right? And with these ratios, we can see what the degree of risk we can pay our interest expenses in the future. Based on the formula, you must take your income before taxes and interest expenses, which is on the income statement, and divide in your interest expenses. These two items you can get from income statement, and you can get the results as here is given 3.9. So that means your income before tax and interest expense is more than interest expense by the four times. This is a good that you can cover, you can pay your interest expenses by your net incomes. Yeah, by your income before tax and interest expenses. That you have enough money, which is more than four times, you can pay your interest expenses by the four times. You see, you have enough money. The higher this results, that is the better for the company. That's all. Next one is the profitability ratio. Okay. Before to proceed the profitability ratios, let me see. I have some arguments about the classes. Okay, don't argue about the classes. As you can see, we are already running the class around 2 hours, and we have left around, let me see how many slides. One, okay, it's enough. enough slides we have, and we have some assignments. Okay, right now we can stop our classes, our class on the profitability ratios. So from the next, which is tomorrow, you remember we have a tomorrow class at the same time, we'll continue with the profitability ratios and we do some practical exercise, okay? So, but before the starting the tomorrow's class, please review this whole presentation. But because maybe I would run quickly as today based on the slide. If you do review one or two times, that would be enough for you to understand more better, and you won't be have a lot of questions. Or you might ask me the question which is really you have is important for you, or you didn't understand at your own study. You see? Okay? We do concentrate on that. Okay. So thank you. Have a good time. See you on tomorrow. So just get relaxed before tomorrow classes. Okay, bye. Goodbye.